118 elements, 118 names, 118 stories. The periodic table is full of secrets and surprises, and in this video, we're going to uncover them. Which elements are named the stinker, the frustrator, and the acid maker? Is it aluminium or aluminum? I'll explain that one later. What mythical beings lurk among the periods and groups, and which places and people are immortalized there too? Enough rhyming now. Also, why do some of the chemical symbols seem to make no sense? Find out now in another Rob Words. I'm going to be in my element with this one. Okay, everybody, let's take it from the top and keep it light with hydrogen, the least dense element and atomic number one. Don't worry, I do not intend to do all 118 elements in numerical order. By the time I'd finished, they'd probably have discovered some more of them. But let's start here because it is one of the elements we're perhaps best acquainted with, but whose name we may never have actually stopped to think about. Hydrogen breaks down into the Greek for water, hydro, and the Greek for to form or to generate, gen. That is the same gen that gives us generate, but also gender, gene, genesis, and generous. So why is hydrogen called that? Because you need it to generate water. In fact, here in Germany, where I'm standing right now, it's called Wasserstoff, which means water stuff, or, you know, water material. The other element of water is oxygen, and there's that gen again. This time the oxy means acid, because it was originally called that under the, it turns out, false belief that you needed it to make an acid. So the name's actually misleading, but it could be worse. The scientists who discovered it in the 1700s originally named it deflagisticated air, so thank God that didn't stick. They also called it fire air, though, which is actually much cooler, or much hotter, I suppose. Anyway, let's generate another of these gen elements. Nitrogen, it's so called because of its presence in nitre, which is a salt. Away from the periodic table, you can actually see the gen suffix in action in carcinogen, something that generates cancer, or pathogen, something that generates a disease or suffering. Actually, I wish I hadn't gone there. That was a bit bleak, wasn't it? So let's lighten things up again with helium. It's also at the top of the table, so it is
high time that we talk about it.
It gets its name from the Greek god of the sun, Helios. Why? Because it was first detected in the corona of the sun. Corona itself means crown, and it's the bit you see surrounding the sun when there's an eclipse. It's that shiny aura. The at the end of helium is something that we are going to encounter a lot going forward. So let's take a moment to look at it. So both and eum are just suffixes used to turn something into a substance, etymologically speaking, or specifically into an element. For example, lithium gets its name from the Greek for stone. Stone is already a material, but the eum gives us an element named after it. The fact that there are two similar ways to do this with and eum is the reason that we have two names for this element here. Now, I've always called it aluminium, but it also gets called aluminum. Now, I know you want me to tell you which one is right, don't you? Well, if only it were so elementary. So, aluminium is recorded first as the name for the element you get from alumina. That was in 1811, but then aluminum is seen being used in 1812. So neither one of them is the long-established term and the other one an abominable mispronunciation. They are both good. For a while, in fact, there was a third option, aluminium, but let's just leave that one buried safely in the ground. Instead, let's look at some more of the big hitters from the periodic table. So carbon gets its name from the Latin for coal. Coal itself is composed mostly of carbon, and today the words for coal in the Latin languages are something along the lines of carbon. Next up is gold. Gold is a very old word. We've been calling it something along those lines for as long as we can trace the Germanic languages back. But it's thought that its ultimate root is in Proto-Indo-European hela, meaning yellow. But hang on a second. What's going on here? Its symbol is AU. Now, neither of those letters is in the word gold. So what is cracking off here? Well, that's actually short for the Latin name for gold, aurum. Coming in just behind gold, as it usually does, is silver. Now that's another old Germanic word, but again, what is going on with that chemical symbol? Well, Ag is short for its Latin name as well, argentum in this case, from which we actually get the name of the country Argentina, because when the Spaniards rocked up in the Americas in the 16th and 17th centuries, they were rather excited about the large amounts of the precious metal that they were able to take back with them. They named Argentina using the Latin word for silver, but there is an element named after the Spanish word for silver too. Platinum comes from the Spanish plata. It means little silver element. Platina is a cute little version of plata. Basically, the Spaniards thought that platinum was an inferior form of silver. How wrong they turned out to be. And there's another element named after silver too. Ready, Freddy? It's mercury. So our word mercury comes from the name of the Roman god, but the chemical symbol is Hg, which is short for the Greek hydrargyrum. Now we've seen the elements of that word before. The hydra bit is water, like in hydrogen, and the argyrum is silver. Hydrargyrum means water silver. In fact, mercury used to be called, in English, quicksilver, which means liquid silver, because that's basically what it looks like. So Argentina may be named after an element, but it's actually far more common for elements to be named after places. However, some of them are by no means obvious. One place has more elements named after it than any other, and I'm willing to bet that you've never even heard of it. It's this place just outside of the Swedish capital, Stockholm. Now, I had no idea how to pronounce this. Is it Ytterby, Ytterby? Absolutely no clue. But I did happen to be in Stockholm the other day, so I took the opportunity to ask a Swede. And after pouring me a lovely coffee, barista Isaac kindly obliged.
How's it pronounced?
Ytterby.
And again for me.
Ytterby.
Thank you so much.
Ytterby. Ytterby. Still can't get it right. Anyway, back in 1789, the first rare earth metal compound was found in a lump of rock taken from a mine at
Ytterby.
And since then, a whole host of brand new elements have been identified there. Among them, yttrium and ytterbium, which are both quite obviously named after the place. But so also is terbium and indeed erbium. So a whole four elements are named after that one tiny town on the Baltic coast. 0 points for creativity though. I bet they wanted to call the next one just bium. But they didn't. But other elements were found there. One of them was named holmium after nearby Stockholm. Another one was called scandium from Scandia, the Latin name for Scandinavia. And there's also thulium, which comes from Thule, an ancient Greek and Latin word for what they believed to be the most northerly region of the world. Tantalum was also found at, and in a bit of a sidestep, was named after the Greek mythological character Tantalus. Now that poor fellow was doomed to an eternity of hunger and thirst, standing under a tree of fruit that he couldn't reach and in a pool of water that he couldn't drink. We get the word tantalizing from him to express a desire that is, you know, just beyond our grasp. And tantalum is named after him because it's really difficult to separate from its ore. Another element, niobium, is named after King Tantalus's daughter, Niobe, because tantalum and niobium are always found together. More on Greek mythology to come, but let's look at some more elements that are named after places first. Now, France gets two elements named after it. Francium, which is obvious, but also gallium, which gets its name from the Latin name for France, Gallia. Other elements named after places include polonium, named after Marie Curie's homeland, which was not France, but Poland. Copper is ultimately named after the island of Cyprus, from where the Romans sourced most of theirs. And some other examples are truly out of this world. Selenium gets its name from the Greek word for the moon, Selene. And uranium, neptunium, and plutonium are all named after planets. There are loads of others named after places too. I'm not going to go through all of them, but you can see them all there. Now, the planets Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto get their names from Greek and Roman gods, and there are also plenty of mythical figures hidden within the periodic table. Titanium is named after the Titans, the fearsome Greek deities who preceded the Olympian gods before being banished to the depths of the underworld. Promethium is named after one of the Titans in particular, Prometheus, who, according to the Greeks, stole fire from the other gods and gave it to humans. He was punished by having an eagle peck out his liver every day for eternity. The name of the element is a nod to the excruciating difficulty scientists experienced trying to synthesize promethium. Cadmium gets its name from the Greek mythological king Cadmus, who Greek historian Herodotus claims was responsible for handing the Phoenician alphabet to the Greeks, a lovely little crossover fact if you watched my video about the origins of our alphabet. Norse mythology is also represented in the periodic table in the forms of thorium, named after thunder god Thor, and vanadium, which comes from one of the many Old Norse names for the goddess Freya. There are also a couple of other mischievous mythical fellows hiding within the table of elements. They're disguised in the forms of cobalt and nickel. Now, cobalt comes from a German word meaning a pixie or a goblin, kobold, and nickel is actually a shortening of the German word kupfernickel. Kupfer means copper, and nickel is another mischievous demon. So kupfernickel is a sort of copper imp. Cobalt and nickel get their impish names because of the ways they confounded the miners who tried to dig them up. Nickel fooled them into thinking that they were mining copper, and cobalt actually made them ill, or so the miners thought. It was actually probably more likely the arsenic and sulfur that it was mixed in with. Actually, a fair few elements get their names simply from the fact that they are hard to extract. It's as if the scientists were so livid about the trouble that they'd had to go to isolate or synthesize them that they took it out on the elements themselves. Krypton is not named after Superman's home planet, but the Greek word for hidden. Lanthanum is also named for its shyness, I suppose, and so is dysprosium. Xenon comes from the same root as xenophobia. It's from the Greek for strange or foreign. Xenon gets called the stranger gas, not because it's antisocial though, but because it's uncharacteristically reactive for a noble gas. They're called noble because of their reluctance to be associated with other lesser elements. These elements are also all named after their specific characteristics. My favourite among them is argon, which gets its name from the Greek for lazy, just because it basically can't be asked to react with anything. And also there's poor old osmium, which gets its name from the Greek for stink, because it smells, or at least the compound the scientist who named it was working with did. And often scientists themselves end up being immortalized in the names of elements. Curium is named after Pierre and Marie Curie. Einsteinium is, well, do I really need to tell you? And there's also nobelium and
copernicium,
named after Alfred Nobel of dynamite and Nobel Prize fame, and Renaissance brain box Nicolaus Copernicus. All of these other elements are also named after people too. Some you may have heard of, others maybe not. Now, I want to mention some more of the confusing name chemical symbol combinations. We already talked about mercury, gold, and silver. So what about lead? Well, lead gets its chemical symbol from the Latin for lead, plumbum. We get our word plumber from the same root because water pipes were often made of lead. Tin, potassium, and iron also get their apparently nonsensical chemical symbols from Latin names for the same metals. And special mention goes to tungsten, which has the chemical symbol W. Tungsten comes from the Swedish for heavy stone, simple and descriptive. But the old name for tungsten was wolframite, which comes from the German Wolfram, meaning wolf's cream.
Hello. Hi.
Okay, so in an ideal world, I would not be finishing my video with the words wolf's cream, but those are all the elements that I am going to go into in this one. Any that I haven't mentioned, it's actually because their explanation is extremely simple, very similar to another one, or actually I just found their origin a little bit, how shall I put it, boron. Thanks a lot for watching. This actually took quite a bit of work, so if you've enjoyed it, please do hit the subscribe button. Next, I recommend you watch my video about the origins of the words for colours. If you've already seen it though, why not try this one out instead? And I'll see you over there.